All right, good morning. I'm Meg King, as Zach said, the director of the Digital Futures Project at the Wilson Center, which focuses on the way in which technology is changing foreign and national security policy. Obviously, technology is playing an increasingly important role in the intelligence space, and today we're here to discuss what's on the Intel reform agenda in Washington. So, what are the hottest topics on the minds of policymakers? Our panel this morning has agreed to narrow the rather large field to three topics: encryption, encryption, and encryption. Oh, and we'll also tackle surveillance and the future of secrecy and leaks after the release of the Panama Papers. So let me introduce our panel. We have Ellen Nakashima, who's a national security reporter for the Washington Post. She covers the Justice Department and focuses on issues at the nexus of privacy and security. She also writes about cyber policy and cyber warfare, and in 2014 was part of a reporting team that won the Pulitzer Prize for public service for a series of stories exploring the implications of national security agency surveillance programs. She served as Southeast Asia correspondent for the Post from 2002 to 2006, covering Islamic militant networks, the Indian Ocean tsunami, and the SARS outbreak. And since joining the Post in 95, she covered the White House and Virginia state politics. Harvey Rishikof is senior counsel at Crowell and Mooring and the senior advisor, formerly co-chair of the ABA National Task Force on Cybersecurity and the Law. Most recently, he was dean of faculty at the National War College and held a joint appointment at Drexel University in the law and iSchools. His last government position was senior policy advisor to the director of national counterintelligence at the ODNI. And Rishikof has authored many publications and monographs, including the article Morality, Ethics, and Law in the War on Terrorism as part of the West Point Terrorism Series, Countering Terrorism and Insurgency in the 21st Century. And there's a new edition coming of the National Security Enterprise, Navigating the Labyrinth, in this year, if I'm correct. So let's dive right in. Encryption. The public-private sector fight, if you want to call it that, over encryption seems to be raising some important constitutional questions, like free speech, privacy rights, and whether the US government has a right to force companies to carry out additional labor to provide access to information for investigations. Can each of you give a recap of the biggest fights in the last few months and what's ahead?
Thank you, Meg, and thank you to Sam and Zach at the Center on Law and Security and to Jane at the Wilson Center for hosting this event. It's an honor to be here. As all of you know, unless you've been off the grid for the last couple of months, the biggest fight is one everyone is familiar with, the fight between Apple and the FBI over access to data on a terrorist's iPhone. But let me start by making an observation. Traditionally, in the debate over surveillance, the framing has been one of privacy versus security or civil liberties versus public safety. What you've started to see recently is some privacy advocates and experts trying to reframe the debate as one about security versus security, or cybersecurity versus public safety. As one explained to me, by doing this, they're trying to bring folks from the public safety side of the debate over to their side. They're attempting to force public safety advocates to pick the threat they are most worried about: terrorists and drug dealers, or Chinese and Russian hackers. Then you have the public safety advocates, as Jane so eloquently expressed today, saying they don't want to force a choice between privacy and security. It should be possible to have both. But then their argument runs smack up against the tech guys who say there's no way to design a system that is secure from both foreign government hackers and also accessible to law enforcement. As soon as you do that, you've lost the cybersecurity game. You can't have both. You can't be just a little bit pregnant. Now, so stepping back a little here, the encryption debate is part of a larger phenomenon that the FBI has called going dark. They began warning about it 5 or 6 years ago, saying that people, including bad guys, were moving away from traditional phones that they could wiretap to online chat and other news media that they couldn't, even with a warrant. Encryption wasn't a big part of the debate then, but in just the last year and a half, It's moved from being a minor part to a major part of going dark. And I remember the point at which it changed. It was the September 2014 announcement by Apple that its new operating system, iOS 8, encrypted data on iPhones by default. Unless the user backed up data to iCloud, the company said it had no way of retrieving the clear text when served with a warrant because it didn't have the key. Google quickly followed suit with its own announcement, even though it hasn't rolled out encryption quite as uniformly as Apple. Nonetheless, this was the first salvo in what has been a year and a half long tussle between law enforcement, tech firms, and civil society over encryption, privacy, and public safety. Now, Apple actually had begun to roll out strong encryption on its instant message and voice apps before, several years before the Snowden disclosures. So it wasn't just a reaction to Snowden. But the leaks certainly did give more urgency to their efforts as they sought to dispel the perception that they were inappropriately aiding government surveillance. I'd argue that leaks marked the beginning of a crisis in trust in tech companies, in the government, and of the tech companies in government. And in response to Apple and Google, FBI Director James Comey said he could not understand why companies would, quote, market something expressly to allow people to place themselves beyond the law. He cast what they did in terms of a strategic business decision. And over the last year, crypto experts and privacy advocates have sparred with law enforcement officials over the policy issues, often talking past one another. Each side used terms that to the other felt loaded, like backdoor and warrant-proof encryption. You had academics trying to influence the debate. One group put out a paper called Keys Under Doormats that concluded that enabling law enforcement access would create undue risks to cybersecurity. And another group, which included former national security officials, put out a report titled Don't Panic that found that though law enforcement is facing encryption challenges, there are other avenues to obtaining clues, such as through metadata, like email headers that denote time, place, and who's in contact with whom. They also pointed out that encryption runs counter to some companies' business models. For instance, Google and Facebook need to be able to see people's messages to serve up ads against them. And so the government will always have that source of data. Yet the government uses that very point to make the argument that some firms choose to hold keys, or what some might call backdoors, for business purposes. And that data is, they argue, still reasonably secure while being accessible to law enforcement. So much of the debate had centered around whether the Obama administration would force companies to provide law enforcement access. And then last September, the administration, in a pivotal decision, decided it would not seek a legislative mandate, at least not for now. Silicon Valley portrayed it as a win. Law enforcement said it had won something too. It had blocked an effort to get the president to explicitly disavow a legislative mandate. Then came the Paris attacks, and in December, the San Bernardino shooting rampage. With 14 killed, it was the deadliest terrorist attack on US soil since 9/11. The FBI recovered a cell phone that had been used by one of the attackers, Syed Rizwan Farouk. And he and his wife, before they were killed in a shootout with police, had pledged loyalty to the Islamic State. Now, Farouk's phone belonged to his employer, the San Bernardino County, which had given the FBI permission to have it searched. The phone, however, was running an iOS 9 operating system, which meant that Apple had no immediately available means to recover data from the locked phone. If there ever were a set of facts sympathetic to the government, this was it. A dead terrorist, 14 innocent victims, and the phone's owner had given permission to have it searched. Then in February, the Justice Department obtained a court order from a magistrate judge in Riverside, California, directing Apple to write software that would disable security features on the phone so that the FBI itself could attempt to crack the phone's PIN code. Apple immediately objected, and CEO Tim Cook accused the Justice Department of ordering Apple to hack its own customers, of demanding a backdoor, of creating a new version of its operating system that could, in the wrong hands, have the potential to unlock any iPhone. So now we had a showdown between the world's most valuable company and the FBI being watched around the world. There was a month of back and forth charges. Comey countered they weren't seeking a backdoor, they weren't trying to set a precedent. They wanted merely to get access to that one terrorist's phone. In March, President Obama weighed in an interview in South by Southwest. He said that those who argue that there should be strong encryption no matter what are fetishizing our phones above every other value, and that can't be the right answer. And then less than 2 weeks later, the Justice Department revealed that a third party had come forward to the FBI with a potential method to help gain access to the phone. They put oral arguments on hold, and a week later, the department withdrew its order, saying that the Bureau had successfully cracked the phone. So what was expected to be a months-long, high-profile legal battle was suddenly averted. But the tension and the questions, both policy and legal, remain. So on the policy side, some questions. Should the government have legal authority to force tech companies to provide access? If so, what should the scope of that access be, given competing concerns about cybersecurity and economic security? Should cost to reputation be factored into the burden analysis? And on the technical side, will building in exceptional access for law enforcement greatly weaken the security of the system? Or is it true that once you build an access, that's it, game over, you're inviting hackers to steal the crown jewels? Now, I was at a hearing on the Hill this week where the FBI kept stressing that it wanted to work with industry and wanted a cooperative relationship. And Apple emphasized how it already worked closely with the government in criminal investigations, helping to find child predators and the like. Yet when it comes to this thorny issue, the two sides can't seem to come to a compromise. To close, I'll say rebuilding trust in companies, trust in government, and companies' trust in government is going to take some time. But in the end, that may be the only way to achieve a workable compromise.
Thank you, Ellen, for that recap. Harvey, I'd like your reaction from the legal perspective, but also from both of you. Should the FBI be required to disclose the vulnerability they've obviously identified to crack that San Bernardino terrorist's phone? So,
great.
Harvey.
So first, let me thank Sam and Zach and Jane for putting this together. It's a wonderful forum. And I had to work with Jane and Mike when I was at the government, and I want to thank you for your service, because you're not thanked enough for public service. And I have to make the traditional caveats. I still have affiliations with the government, so everything I say is my own and all the organizations that I'm affiliated with. So I approach the issue a little bit differently, and I would say the first is the core issue for me, which is that's gonna come to a head, is a battle of the concept of sovereignty. And we have a concept in which either the sovereign will be able to pass legislation which will allow that sovereign on its area of responsibility to have access to information that it believes is performed under our constitutional due process rights. You also will have Russia and China, which will have their sense of sovereignty, and they are asserting their sovereignty against the system by requiring either data to be maintained jurisdictionally in their actual countries, or mandating when companies come to play in their markets that they must have certain requirements. And the international market community is responding to that. So will the sovereignty reside with our traditional nation-state sovereigns, or will it reside with the product or the company? So this first became clear, I think, to me years ago when my old friend Scott Charney from Microsoft and I were at one of these conferences. And he was asserting that, you know, we have to be careful because we have a product that is marketed around the world. And if there are, quote, only back doors for the United States, that will be problematic for us to have a world product. So that, to me, is at the core of where this debate is going to go. Second issue. The second issue is what we're fighting over, which is appropriate Fourth Amendment understanding of when the government can have access to data. And I think given the world of technology, our traditional legal framework, which is the third party doctrine that many of you the lawyers are familiar with in Smith, is just not maybe appropriate given where we were in the 1970s when that doctrine was put forward and where we are now about what expectations of privacy are. The third point is on encryption, which when I'm in Silicon Valley, one of the interesting questions is if you're committed to the concept of encryption, you probably would be supportive of encrypting metadata. So I call this the geek wonk debate. because the geeks have a level of where they stand on these technological issues that, quite frankly, the wonks are a little bit at sea at. For instance, how many people in this room can write an algorithm? Raise your hand. Well, they are the most significant dangerous people. Jane, you're always dangerous for a variety of reasons. But that notion of what the baseline was. So when this debate came up about 3 weeks ago, 4 weeks ago when I was at MIT, I was in front of a text and I said, well, the Bureau's position is there. It's a very discreet analysis in this law case because they have consent from the owner of the phone. And what they're asking for is a form of access that they were asking from Apple, so that in the event they would use brute force, because it's an only four-digit code, and you can crack the code in about 4 or 5 minutes, basically with supercomputers. There was a program that would then destroy the data. So they were asking only for assistance in order to have a program not destroy the data. It's a very technical, different notion than just raw encryption. And the second major legal argument involved was the All Writs Act. So the question is, the All Writs, the 18th century act, how many of you believe that we should be using 18th century doctrines? Well, I guess the reason you raise your hands is because do you believe in the writ of habeas corpus or not? So just because it's old per se doesn't mean it's bad. It's the allocation. And I'll end with the final point, which is that. So then the question would be, who is covered? So if you know, there's current legislation being put forward by Senator Feinstein and Senator Burr about what a covered entity is, because for those of us who are old enough, we remember the CALEA wars, the Communications Assistance Law Enforcement Act, and the clipper chip wars. And we said if you were a special telecommunications provider, you had to give access pursuant to due process. We have the technology has collapsed what telecommunications is, who's a provider. So one of the arguments is we should not be Apple. We don't fall under those traditional CALEA views. If this is going to go forward, the Congress should do something and pass legislation. We shouldn't be leaving it to the courts. And the last point I'll make to you, I know if you, today, Wednesday, just came down on the Iranian case for the freezing of the $1.27 billion that we now have access to. Interesting decision, 6-2. The two dissenters, the Chief Justice and Sotomayor. Why? They're asserting the role of the courts to resolve these problems. And the six are saying, no, the legislature has a role. They stepped into the litigation, and they said the litigation can go forward. This is the exact analysis that we're having in this case. Should Congress be stepping forward as to the access in the Fourth Amendment, as opposed to the courts? But in the end, someone's going to have to decide, my first point, where is that sovereignty going to lie, and who's going to have the right to assert their sovereignty? I'll end with that.
So you mentioned CALEA, and that's interesting because going back to the 1990s, Congress very specifically then were, they regulated, they put phone companies and then later broadband under regulation, but left out internet companies that at the time were still fledgling and also encryption. So the question is going forward, because I agree, I think Congress is the right place to decide the sovereignty issue. But there's been a lot of tension over the years about whether or not tech companies, internet companies, social media companies ought to be drawn into this regulatory framework. And there's been great opposition to that with lots of arguments that doing so would stifle innovation. And it became almost an article of faith that you couldn't reopen CALEA, you couldn't reopen CALEA to cover internet companies. And thus, because of that, in a sense, we're in this predicament we're in today, because Congress has not chosen to put these tech companies, as Apples and Facebooks, under a framework that would require them to create some method of access to make their communications wiretappable or clear to the government. And so what has the government done? It's used this All Writs Act law to try to get technical compliance or technical assistance from the companies. And for the most part, up until a couple of years ago, it worked. Apple was actually complying and extracting data from its iPhones for law enforcement with a warrant until it came to its newer phones, which have a type of encryption that the company itself can't unlock because it doesn't have a key.
We've got to move on because we've got a couple more.
Let me respond to your zero-day issue, which is a classic policy issue.
Right. And can I just, before you get into that, I just wanted to mention that I think it's important, and we don't need to describe exactly how, but there is a role of user error here. And not everyone uses the technology to the full extent, and you have to opt into certain requirements to make sure that you are actually using the software.
So that's a quick one. If you speak to people who are going to be the cloud providers, what the cloud providers love is you can scale that issue. Mm-hmm. So you scale the issue, which is that you no longer have to rely on the individual user. If they're in the cloud, they can immediately put on the apps and attributes they want. The only disadvantage of that is it's the Pearl Harbor problem, is that wouldn't be a great idea to put our destroyers in one little place and see how that works for efficiency. And if anyone ever gets into that cloud and has that access to the cloud, that's going to be a very bad hair day. The second issue is the 0 days, which is that the 0 days are, there are very few products we put on the market that we know are inherently bad. And we spend a lot of money for. The only people I know who normally do that are Jaguar owners. How many Jaguar owners do that? So other than Jaguar, who spent a lot of money for the product, we have allowed the market system to go forward so that we're constantly updating the software. That means for at least a 30-day period, you're using a defective product that may have advantages that people can get into. Second point, there's cyber crime, Title 18, cyber espionage, Title 50, cyber war, Title 10. We all play on the same platform. So for cyber espionage, having 0-day defects that you alone know are really effective. Well, what is the obligation of the government to go forward to tell the world and the products that exist? That's why we now have an equities committee, and we try to figure out the balance as to where we are in this. When we originally put out Microsoft, NSA looked at it, and they found hundreds and hundreds of problems, and they told the company about it before it went on the product, went on the marketplace. So your question raises a real tight policy issue, which is there's an advantage that we have sometimes when I'm wearing my Title 50 hat that is different than my Title 18 hat. So now, as you know, we have bug bounties. People get $100,000 in order for you to find the bug and tell the company and improve the product. But we have not resolved the equity problem of where we are. And until we have software that comes out that doesn't have this level of defects, the encryption issue is a side issue. And I guess the final point would be is if you are successful in making really hard encryption, there are only two moments in time in which then the data is open. At the beginning, when you undo it, and when you read it. That means law enforcement will have to be even more intrusive under the Fourth Amendment in order to get to those two critical points. So be careful for what you wish for. And I'm a card-carrying member of the ACLU and with the Bureau. I wear both hats and see the issue of be careful what you ask for what the state will have to do lawfully to get at that information if the encryption rule is extremely successful in blocking everything and saying we can't do anything.
Unless we don't patch that SS7 vulnerability, but I think we'll get there. Ellen, last comment.
Quick 2 points on that. One is in the case of the Apple iPhone, Apple has already said it actually isn't going to pressure the government or sue the government for access to the vulnerability or to disclose the vulnerability because it thinks that it won't have a long shelf life, that Apple's continuing improvements to its own security will make the solution, the tool that the FBI has, obsolete. And it's, you know, the FBI itself has said that it doesn't think that the solution will last very long. And at the same time, there is this vulnerabilities equities process that Harvey mentioned, which is run by the White House. But the process is not a presidential directive or order. It is sort of an agreement among agencies about with equities that once, if one of them comes up with a vulnerability or flaw to software, that they should submit it to the process. If it is a flaw that has previously been unknown, like a zero day, and it's one that was recently discovered. And in that process, there are different equities that are weighed. One of the questions is, well, just how widespread is the software that the flaw is on? Is it used by everyone, or is it just used by Chinese PLA hackers? And secondly, how useful is the tool that the vulnerability is based on to either the intelligence agency or law enforcement? Is there some important investigation that the use of this tool can advance? And sometimes there can be a little bit of a balancing act where you can let the agency use the tool for a couple of months while the company works on a patch for the vulnerability. So you could have disclosure, but in a delayed fashion. At times you might want to just withhold it, you know, because you think it's going to be useful for a long time for national security purposes. So I think I'll
start with that. Well, thanks to our panel. Sadly, we didn't make it to surveillance and the future of secrecy and leaks, but we'll, I'm sure,
we'll
deal with
back.
It later.
Happy to come
You'll
back.
You'll come back. Thank you.
Thank you.